Okay, good morning once again one and all. So today in this particular video lecture, you will understand the concept of magnification factor. Now first of all, let us understand what is magnification factor. Now basically, magnification factor is denoted by MA and it is nothing but the ratio of X upon XST. Right? So already we have understand what is X and what is XST. So X is nothing but the steady state amplitude, or you can also call it as the amplitude of steady state vibrations or the amplitudes of force vibration produced by external harmonic force F0 sin omega t. That is nothing but the X, and XST is nothing but, it is also called as the static amplitude or zero frequency deflection, means a static deflection which is produced by static force F0. So that is XST is nothing but the F0 by k, which we have already understand in the basic formula of force vibration. So now the ratio of this steady state amplitude to the static amplitude is called as the magnification factor. So finally, how we can define the magnification factor? So I can write this as X is equal to XST into M dot F. So what this equation means, a mathematical equation number one, means that the magnification factor, or it is also called as a dynamic magnifier, is a factor by which static deflection XST produced by a static force F0 must be multiplied in order to obtain the amplitude of force vibration X produced by the harmonic force F0 sin omega t. Means what? To obtain X, you have to multiply XST by MF. That is nothing but the magnification factor or dynamic magnifier. So from this you will get X, that is a steady state amplitude. So finally, this MF, now we know that the X, that is a steady state amplitude, is given by F0 upon K square root of 1 minus R square bracket square plus 2 zeta R bracket square. Now as I earlier said that XST is nothing but a static amplitude, or you can also call it as a static deflection produced by the static force F0. So it is given by F0 upon K. Right? So now, so this equation becomes, instead of writing F0 upon K, I can write this as a XST upon this square root term. So from this I will get magnification factor is equal to X upon XST is equal to 1 upon the square root term. That is 1 minus R square bracket square plus 2 zeta R bracket square. So this equation or this expression is used to calculate the magnification factor, which is also a dynamic factor or dynamic magnifier. So I hope you have understand this magnification factor. Now once you have understand this magnification factor, now let us understand the frequency response curve. What is frequency response curve? The plot of magnification factor versus frequency ratio is called as a frequency response curve. That is, on the x-axis we will plot R, which is nothing but the frequency ratio omega by upper omega n, and on the y-axis we will plot MF. What is MF? X upon XST. So the plot of MF versus frequency ratio is called the frequency response curve. So this is the first plot we will be understanding in the frequency response curve. And the second plot is nothing but the phase angle plot, which is nothing but on x-axis we are taking R is equal to omega by omega n. On the y-axis we are taking phi, that is nothing but the phase angle. What is phase angle? The angle by which displacement vector lacks the force vector, which we have already understand in the lecture number one. Okay. Now basically, when you consider any of the practical systems, there are two types of phases in the sinusoidal vibration or in the oscillatory behavior of a vibration. That is, the first is the transient vibration and second is nothing but a steady state vibration. Now as I have explained in the lecture number one, transient vibration vanishes or dies out within a short time, a short period of time called as a settling time. What is settling time? The time taken by the system to reach the steady state. And the steady state vibrations remains behind, right? After the transient vibrations vanishes out. For example, if you draw the graph, so initially these are nothing but a transient vibrations, and finally this transient vibration, that is amplitude, will go on decreasing, and finally the phase will come which is called the steady state phase, and where you will have a steady state vibration, means what? The vibrations or the amplitudes at a constant rate, or you can call it as a constant amplitude also. So this phase is called the steady state phase, CSS of T, and this phase is called the CT of T, the transient phase. So the vibration corresponding to the transient state are called the transient vibrations, and the vibrations corresponding to the steady state phase are called the steady state vibrations. For detail, you can also watch video number 1, right? So that is why, since the since steady state vibrations remains behind and transient vibration vanishes out, it is very, very important to study the steady state behavior subjected to the different excitation frequencies. That is, on the x-axis, we are varying frequency from 0 to omega, or you can also call it as a, we are varying frequency ratio, that is 0 to infinity, we are varying frequency ratio, that is r is equal to omega by omega n. So when this frequency ratio is varied, okay, so how does this steady state behave? Steady state, what are the behavior of steady state vibrations, that we have to understand. Next, so basically, as I have explained earlier, that so in this frequency response analysis, we will be understanding two curves, that is the steady state amplitude x versus frequency ratio and phase angle versus frequency ratio, as I have earlier at the start, as I have explained earlier at the start, right? So now, finally, what you can conclude, this curve reveals a lot of useful information regarding the behavior of the system to the sinusoidal excitation. So that is why we have to understand both the curves. So let us understand one by one. The first curve is nothing but the frequency response curve, that is frequency ratio R versus steady state ratio of steady state amplitude to the static amplitude, that is a magnification factor. Now let us understand one by one what are the observations in this particular frequency response curve. The first observation says that magnification factor is maximum when R is equal to 1. That is what? When R is equal to 1, that is at resonance, what is R is equal to 1 means what? Omega by omega n is equal to 1. Therefore, omega is equal to omega n. So at this resonance condition, you can say that this R magnification factor is close to this 4, right? So that is why at resonance condition, your MF becomes maximum, right? So this is already, we have studied that resonance is a dangerous condition and you have to avoid this, and that is why we are providing some amount of damping always in the force for a system subjected to the force vibration or a periodic harmonic periodic excitation, right? Now as the damping ratio decreases, the maximum value of MF increases. Now this is straightforward. Now we know that MF is nothing but a x upon xst. Now as I earlier said, that as the value of zeta goes on increasing up to the certain limit, okay, so this steady state amplitude will be controllable, or they will go on decreasing, right? So let us say xst is nothing but the static deflection. So if I keep this xst constant and if I go on increasing the value of zeta, so obviously this x will go on decreasing, right? So your MF value will also decrease, and vice versa. If I decrease the value of zeta, that is if I provide a less amount of damping in the system, so obviously this x will go on increasing and you will get a maximum value of MF, that is a magnification factor. So in this particular figure also, we can see that as the value of zeta is 2, 1, 0.5, so as this 0.125 and then 0, so as the value of zeta goes on decreasing, you can see that the value of magnification factor also goes on increasing, and vice versa. This is the second observation. Third, now at zeta is equal to 0, zeta is equal to 0 is also called as an undamped condition, means what? We are not providing any sort of damping. So when zeta is equal to 0, what will happen? The MF will reach to the infinity. You can see that, you can see this point number A and this point number P. So this point number A and point number shows that when zeta is equal to 0, your MF reaches to the infinity, that is, it is moving to the infinity. Okay, MF is reaching towards the infinity. Is it clear? So since MF is reaching towards the infinity, means what? The system will undergo destruction, means what? System will fail. Normally, your system will fail when there is a resonance condition, that R is equal to 1. So let us say this is the R point, where R is equal to 1, but when there is no damping, when zeta is equal to, you can see that this A point is before R, means what? The system may undergo destruction before the resonance condition. Or this B point indicates that sometime the system may undergo destruction after the resonance condition. So this is what happens when zeta is equal to 0. At omega is equal to 0, that is at 0 frequency, MF is 1. You can see that all the curves of a MF magnification factor start from 1 at corresponding value of frequency 0. So whatever will be the value of zeta, your MF will be always 1 when omega is equal to 0, that is R is equal to 0, obviously. So this means that damping does not have any effect on the phase angle at omega is equal to 0 or R is equal to 0, that is frequency ratio, right? The next observation is that at high frequency, MF tends to 0. You can see that this, as the damping factor goes on increasing, okay, that is zeta is equal to 1, zeta is equal to 2, okay, MF will also go on decreasing, and also as the frequency goes on increasing, let us say 1, 2, 3, as the frequency goes on increasing, you can see that this frequency response, sorry, MF curve, magnification factor curve, is tending towards the 0, right? So means what? Your, as the frequency ratio increases, your MF will move on towards the 0, will tend towards the 0, okay? And last but not least, the significance value of zeta, that is zeta is greater than 0.0707 is the significance value of the zeta, and that is why it is shown by the dotted line. Why it is significant value of zeta? Because you can see that when the value of zeta is greater than 0.707, so as the value of zeta is above 0.707 or 0.707, you can see that this MF, the value of magnification factor, that is the steady state amplitude, obviously, the ratio of steady state amplitude to the static amplitude, is less than 1. This is the one, this is the unity line. So all the curves lies below this line, below this 0.1. Means what? Your magnification factor is very, very less when your value of zeta is greater than 0.707. But when this zeta is less than 701, what happens? You can see that at the value of 0.5, magnification factor goes on increasing and it is above the unity. 0.25, 0.125, and for 0 again it will go towards the infinity. So that is why this 0.707 is nothing but a significance value of zeta, because above and below it there is a drastic change in the magnification factor curve. I hope it is clear to all of you. So these are nothing but the 5 to 6 observations of a frequency response curve of a frequency ratio versus magnification factor. I hope it is clear to you. Now, let us understand the observations made from the frequency, from the phase angle versus frequency response curve. So you can see that on the x-axis we have a R, that is the frequency ratio, which varies from 0 to 3, and on the y-axis we have a phase angle which varies from 0 to 180 degree. Okay, and then you can see that all the curves which start from the 0 meet somewhere at the point where the phase angle is 90 degree, and again they disperse. So they meet at this common point. So you can call this as a common point where corresponding phi is equal to 90 degree, okay, and R is equal to 1. So this is the common point where R is equal to 1 and phi is in 90 degree, where all the curves meet, and then again they disperse. Okay, so let us understand the significance behind this. The phase angle varies from 0 degree. So it varies from 0 degree, let us say, to the 180 degree. So when it varies from a 0 degree, when it starts from a 0 degree, the corresponding frequency ratio is low, that is, it is less than 1, okay? And as the phase angle moves towards the 180 degree, you can see that the frequency ratio goes on increasing, that is, it is greater than 1. So let us say this is a 1 point. So below this 1 point, behind this 1 point, the frequency ratio is obviously low. So phase angle varies from 0 degree to 90 degree, let us say. Okay, and from this 90 degree to 180 degree, it varies as the frequency ratio increases. Okay, so this is the first observation. Second observation is that at resonance, phase angle is 90 degree for all values of damping. Let us say, so this is the point where R is equal to 1 and phi is always 90 degree. Okay, so we know that we can calculate phase angle 10 phi is equal to 2 zeta R upon 1 minus R square. So here, if I am putting R is equal to 1 and let us say any value of zeta, 0.25, 2.0, 1.0. So for all values of damping ratio, your phi is always 90 degree. So whenever they will ask you what is the phase angle corresponding to the resonant frequency, it it is always 90 degree without any calculation from this particular graph. Okay. Now for r less than 1 and for r greater than 1, these are the two conditions. For r less than 1, higher the damping factor, higher is the phase angle. Okay, means what? When your frequency ratio, that is r, is less than 1. Okay, means r is less than 1 means what? The graphs or the curves corresponding to this, below this line 1, okay. So in this, what you can see, higher the damping factor, you can see that as the damping factor go on increasing, that is 0.25, 0.5, 1.0, 2.0, you can see that the phase angle increases from 0 degree to 30 degree, 60 degree up to 90 degree. So higher the damping factor, higher the phase angle when r is less than 1. But as r is greater than 1, as the r increases, you can see that in this corresponding squares, okay, what you can see in this corresponding squares, as higher the damping factor means what? As the damping factor goes on increasing, 0.25, 0.5, 0.0, 0.8, you can see that the phase angle starts falling, that the phase angle is lower, okay, that it, let us say it falls, let us say from 180 degree to somewhere around 120 degree, okay. So higher the damping factor, lower is the phase angle. I hope it is clear to all of you. And this variation is particularly because of the damping which is provided inside the system. That is, when a system is subjected to a force vibration, that is a harmonic excitation at 0 sin omega t. So we are providing some amount of damping, and that is why we are getting a variation in the phase angle. And if there is no damping in the system, let us say zeta is equal to 0, the phase angle is either 0 or 180 degree. Either it is 0 when zeta is equal to 0, phase angle is either 0 degree or phase angle is either 180 degree. This is one more observation which you have to remember. Okay. And at r is equal to 1, that is when r frequency ratio is 1, that is a resonance condition, your phase angle suddenly changes from 0 to 180 degrees. It suddenly changes from 0 to 180 degrees. Okay. So I hope you have understood this. Is it clear? Okay. So now once you have understood both the graphs, now let us understand the next concept, that is, what is the peak frequency? Now what is peak frequency first of all? The frequency at which the amplitude becomes maximum. Amplitude become maximum means what? X max. Means what? Here X is equal to X max. So that frequency is called as a peak frequency. So I will explain you one graph. Let us say we are doing a frequency response analysis of some mechanical system. And then I am acquiring a graph, let us say a graph of, let us say omega versus x, and I am getting a frequency response graph after using some FFT analyzer or some spectrum analyzer or some vibration analyzer, and let us say I am getting some graph like this. So from this graph I can see, I can understand that, let us say at this point, corresponding point, I am getting a x max, that is a maximum amplitude. Now the frequency corresponding to this maximum amplitude is nothing but the omega p. So this omega p is also called as a peak frequency, or x max is called as a peak amplitude. It is called as a peak amplitude. Now try to understand that peak x max is the peak amplitude and x resonance is called as a resonant amplitude. Now these two are nothing but a different terms. Resonant amplitude is nothing but the amplitude when there is a resonance in the system, that is the r is equal to 1 or omega is equal to omega. So the frequency corresponding to the resonance condition is nothing but the x resonance, that is a resonant amplitude, and this x max is nothing but a peak amplitude, and the amplitude corresponding, frequency corresponding to this peak amplitude is called as omega p. Okay, so till now we have understand omega, omega n, omega t and omega p. So 1, 2, 3 and 4 frequencies. What is omega? Frequency of external excitation. Frequency of external excitation, right? Or you can call it the external force. Omega n is nothing but the frequency of free vibration or natural frequency. Okay. Omega d is called the frequency of damped vibration or damped natural frequency, and omega p is nothing but the peak frequency. So these are nothing but the four frequencies till now we have understood. So now already we have derived omega d is equal to omega n into square root of 1 minus zeta square. Now let us derive the equation for the omega p. So let us derive the daily equation for the omega p. So how will we derive? So it is obtained by differentiating mf. What is mf? Differentiating mf with respect to the frequency ratio, that is ddr upon ddr of mf, and equating it 0. So let me call this as equation number 1. So the frequency, peak frequency, is obtained by differentiating magnification factor with respect to the frequency ratio r and equating it to the 0. Now we have x upon xst, right? X upon xst is equal to 1 upon square root of 1 minus r square bracket square plus 2 zeta r bracket square, right? So I can write this as, let us say I am taking this, I am removing the square bracket, so I can write it as 1 by 2. Or you can write this like this as 1 upon 1 minus r square bracket square plus 2 zeta r square bracket square and bracket complete raised to 1 by 2. Okay, so in this way also I can write. Okay, and now if I take this 1 by 2 upwards, that is in the numerator, so this formula becomes x upon xst is equal to 1 minus r square bracket square plus 2 zeta r bracket square raised to minus 1 by 2. Let me call this as equation number 2. Okay, so you can consider this as equation number 2, or you can consider this as equation number 2, and you can differentiate. Now let us say differentiate this equation number 2, or we can also use this equation number 2 and differentiate with respect to the r. That is what you have to do. You have to do ddr of x upon xst and equate it to 0. So let me equate. So what I will get? So derivation of this, 1 minus r square bracket square, I am getting 2 into 1 minus r square into derivative of this r square is nothing but the minus 2r with respect to r plus 2 into 2 zeta r, 2 into 2 zeta r, and derivative of this 2 zeta r is nothing but the 2 zeta, because derivative of r is nothing but the 1, divided by, as it is, minus 1 by 2. So I am taking in the numerator, for the denominator, 2 into 1 minus r square bracket square plus 2 zeta r bracket square raised to 3 by 2 equal to 0. So simple derivation I have used, which you have already studied in the school and college days, right? So now this is what I have derived. So finally, what I will get, let us say solve the brackets. So after solving the brackets, I will get minus 4r plus 4r cube plus 8 zeta square, r is equal to 0. Okay, so this denominator will also become 0 if I equate it to the 0, right? So now from this I will get, let us say 4r common, so minus 1 plus r square plus 2 zeta square is equal to 0. Okay, so now from this, this 4r will, let us say, get cancelled. Okay, so 4r is equal to 0, so remaining is what? Remaining is nothing but the 1 minus 2 zeta square is equal to r square. So from this I am getting r is equal to r max is equal to square root of 1 minus 2 zeta square. So this is nothing but the equation which I am getting, that is equation number 3. So after differentiating mf magnification factor with respect to r and equating 0, what I have got? R max. Now we know that r is equal to omega by omega n, okay, frequency ratio. Now when your r will be maximum, frequency ratio will be maximum, when your omega will be maximum, and let us say omega n as it is. Now what is omega n maximum? Omega maximum is what? Omega p, that is a peak frequency, means what? Omega will be maximum at maximum amplitude. So I can write this as r max is equal to omega p divided by omega n. So I am getting final equation, omega p is equal to r max into omega n, and therefore finally omega p is equal to, what is omega n as it is, and square root of 1 minus 2 zeta square. So this is the final derivation of omega p, which I have got and can be called as equation number 4. Now try to understand the difference between the omega d and omega n. Omega d is equal to omega n into square root of 1 minus zeta square, and omega d is nothing but, omega p is nothing but omega into square root of 1 minus 2 zeta square. This is the difference. Okay, now let us proceed further. Let us say if you want to find out XST max, that is maximum magnification factor. So this magnification factor will be maximum, that is I have to find out MF maximum when your R is maximum, and R is maximum, we have R maximum we have already calculated. So this XST max will be 1 upon square root of 1 minus R square bracket square plus 2 zeta R bracket square. Now let us put here R is equal to R max in this equation. So I will get 1 upon square root of 1 minus, now what is R square? R square is nothing but the R max square, and R max is square root of 1 minus zeta square. So R max square is nothing but the 1 minus 2 zeta square. So I am getting 1 minus 2 zeta square, 1 minus 2 zeta square complete bracket square plus 2 zeta into 1 minus 2 zeta square, and this complete again bracket square. Okay, so this is what I am getting. Now solve this bracket. After solving, what I will get? I will get some terms. So 1 minus 1 square minus 2 zeta square bracket square. So after solving this, I am getting 4 zeta raised to 4 minus 8 zeta raised to 4 plus 4 into zeta square. So solve this both the brackets, you are getting this 3 term, 4 zeta raised to 4 minus 8 zeta raised to 4 plus 4 zeta square. Okay, now 4 zeta raised to 4 minus 8 zeta raised to 4 is nothing but the minus 4 zeta raised to 4 plus 4 zeta square. So finally I am getting MF max is equal to square root of 4 zeta squared minus 4 zeta raised to 4. Okay, so from this I will get what common I can get. From this I can remove 2 zeta common, inside bracket I will get 1 minus zeta square. So MF max, so when they will ask you to find out the MF maximum, that is a maximum magnification factor, its formula or equation is 2 zeta 1 minus zeta square, which we have to remember and use while solving a numerical. So let me call this as equation number 5. Okay, now in this case, if zeta is very less than 1, that is we can say that there is damping, but it is very less, that is zeta is very less than 1, so this equation of MF maximum will become, when zeta is very less, it becomes, you can eliminate this square root term and you can take it as of 1 upon 2 zeta, and you can call this equation number 1. Okay, so in this way, in this lecture we have understand the concept of magnification factor, peak frequency, frequency response curve, and how to calculate the MF maximum as well as the omega p frequency. Okay, so now in the next lecture we will understand how to solve the problems of the force vibration by using some basic formula. Thank you.